Simon & Schuster Audio presents LatinoLand, a portrait of America's largest and least understood minority, by Marie Arana, read by Cynthia Farrell. For Jorge Enrique Arana Cisneros, who passed me this torch, and for Aiden, Ryder, Max, Grayson, Julian, who carry it now. I know who I am and what I might be. Miguel de Cervantes, Spain, 1605. You mind your own business, and I will not ask you any personal questions aside from, how the hell did you get here? Pedro Pietri, poet, New Yorican, 2015. Author's note. We of no name. We are not a race, a nation, a state, a language, a culture. We are the simultaneous transcendence of all these things through something so modern, so unknown, that we still have no name. José Carlos Mariátegui, journalist, Peru, 1929. To tell the truth, we have no name. We never did. When we proliferated through these ancient lands in our countless varietals, we were simply tribes of this hemisphere, inheritors of a natural world, progenitors of a breed. We gave ourselves a multitude of names. Thousands of years later, when we were invaded and conquered, first by Spain, then by a battery of occupiers and usurpers, we became colonies to power, united by the boot, the sword, the crown, the cross, and the Spanish language. As time went on and history raveled, we became citizens of 19 independent republics, admixtures of a crush of skin colors and cultures. We began to call ourselves by the names of our separate nations. Finally, when we found ourselves in the United States of America, some of us finding ourselves here without ever having left our native land, we ceased calling ourselves anything at all. We were amorphous. We were everyone. We were no one. We were invisible. We were chameleons, reflecting every color of man. When asked, we reached for the last turf we had occupied and the last label we had worn. We were Mexicanos, Boricuas, Cubanos, Colombianos, Dominicanos, Peruanos. Although we were no longer anything of the kind. We were Americans long before the founders dreamed of a United States of America. Our ancestors have lived here for more than a half millennium, longer than any immigrant to this hemisphere, and still we come. Indeed, although we arrived long before the Pilgrims, and although we account for more than half of the U.S. population growth over the last decade, and are projected to lead population growth for the next 35 years, it seems as if the rest of the country is perpetually in the act of discovering us. When they do, they give us unfamiliar and puzzling names. President Richard Nixon called us Hispanics, hoping to unify us as a political force that could be counted, organized, and influenced. Yet, though we may speak Spanish, only a fraction of us have Hispanic, or Spanish, blood in our veins. And if we do, the blood quantum itself is but a portion of the whole. That said, many of us accept the name Hispanic, and worthy institutions that support us go by that name. The term Latinos was subsequently imposed on us, although it seemed alien, artificial, an appellation that ancestors in our origin countries would have found odd 200 years ago, even laughable. It derived from the term Latin America, America Latine, a contrivance fashioned by the French of the Napoleonic era, 1799 to 1815, who aimed to colonize Mexico and associate the general region with the southern republics of Europe that speak Romance languages, derived from the Latin language, and distinguish us from the northern origins of the United States. It was a controversial label, smacking of colonialism, but held out, ironically, as an anti-imperialist moniker, specifically against Anglo-Americans. Surprisingly, America Latina, or Latino America, became widely adopted throughout the Central, South, and Caribbean Americas in the 20th century, and over time, the term Latinos stuck, particularly in the Western United States, and especially in the mass media. More recently, activists seeking to render our name gender-neutral out of respect for our LGBTQ members have devised yet another name for us, Latinx. They have done this, although gender in languages is grammatical, not sociological or sexual, and found in linguistic families throughout the world, from French to Russian to Japanese. When I ask the distinguished LGBTQ activist and writer Sherry Moraga whether she uses Latinx to refer to herself, she tells me, "I worked too hard for the A in Latina to give it up. I refer to myself as Chicana." Of our accumulated ethnic population, only a third use Hispanic to identify themselves. A mere 14% use Latino, and less than 2% recognize Latinx. A good number of us choose not to use any identifying term at all. As the prize-winning novelist Junot Díaz tells it, "We have yet to find a name that isn't enforced by a third party, by the academy, the government, the fadmongers, the institutions, a name that gets us where the people live. We are truly Americans of no name. And yet, upon arrival in this country, or if we are indigenous and have been here all along, or Mexicans whose lands were stolen from us in America's westward ho expansion, we accept the denominations we are given. We will respond when called." For purposes of simplification, this book uses Latino, Latina, Hispanic, or Latinx interchangeably, and yet it will seek to explain our grand diversity that defies any one label. This book strives to be a sweeping, personal portrait of our cohort in this country. LatinoLand is populated by a vast citizenry, a multitude of classes, races, historical backgrounds, and cultures. Currently, we number 63 million, or 19% of the United States whole. The U.S. Bureau of the Census predicts that, by 2060, Americans of Hispanic descent will total 111.2 million, almost 30% of the people in this country. The great majority of us are American-born, speak English as well as any native, are employed, obey the law, work hard. It would take a monumental library to capture the grand totality of who we are. So I begin with a deficit, and I ask my readers' indulgence, because one book cannot possibly capture the whole. This book is meant to address, at least in an impressionistic way, stories that go ignored, lives not often seen. Frequently, we are characterized by the famous or the notorious. Glamorous Hollywood luminary Eva Longoria, for instance, or incarcerated drug lord Joaquin El Chapo Guzman, or the great inimitable labor leaders Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta, or baseball giant Roberto Clemente. Our libraries are filled with countless admirable works that portray the good and the bad to perfection. In contrast, this book follows an old entreaty by British historian Edward P. Thompson, who sought to rescue ordinary human beings from the enormous condescension of posterity, the selective amnesia of history, and the arrogance of the great man theory. It is not meant to be a comprehensive work, nor an academic treatise, nor is it intended to lay claim that one canvas can possibly capture the breadth or grandeur of our numbers. We citizens of Latino land hail, after all, from 21 origin countries. We are 63 million on a planet that counts more than a half billion Spanish speakers. It is an impossible task. Perhaps more aptly described, this book is the result of a lifetime of reflection about where we came from, who we once were, what we've become, and what we bring to the United States of America. Many of us identify by the countries from which we emigrated. We are Mexicans, Puerto Ricans, Cubans, Salvadorans, Venezuelans, itinerants from the soil on which our ancestors were born. We only become Latinos, or Hispanics, or Latinx upon arrival, when the U.S. Census asks us to declare, when America stamps us with a name. But whatever the label, it offers a precious unity that Spain, in all its perverse efforts to separate its conquered minions, never did. My own instinct, and that of most of the hundreds of people I interviewed for this book, is to embrace these labels, to get at what it is that unites us, to make the classification truly ours. And so, this is meant to be a journey through the variegated universe of American Latino identity. I mean to stop at its various stations and point out its humanity, its grand array, its surprising connections, its shared sense of otherness. I am grateful to the scores of individuals from different national and ethnic backgrounds representing wildly diverse stations, from domestic servants to university presidents, from grape pickers to corporate executives, who participated in this book via generous and candid interviews. To understand the measure of who we are, I have needed to dig down and study the history of our presence in this country, the centuries we have been here, the randomness of our arrivals, the thousands of years of history that our indigenous populations represent. We may not have a single narrative, but we are united by a number of commonalities. By the fact that we are still considered newcomers, although our ancestors were the first inhabitants of this hemisphere. By being marginalized, virtually unseen. Although
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.